You're listening to musician, author, and educator Bobby Borg, breaking down music, business, and marketing basics so they stick.
Hey everybody, my name is Bobby Borg, and today we're going to be talking about music marketing 2025, and we're going to break this down into three main areas. Number one, social media. Number two, artificial intelligence. And number three, metadata. I've got a really great guest with me today. His name is Dr. Morten Bay. He's a research fellow at the Center for the Digital Future. He is also a musician and educator. So let's go ahead and get started with this. So Morten, in my book, Music Marketing for the DIY Musician, I actually have a chapter called Music Marketing 2025. And in that, I asked some of my colleagues and some industry professionals to make their prognostications about the future and where marketing might be in 2025. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to get your take on their take. Sure. Sound good? Mm-hmm. So let me go ahead and start with social media relationships by Jay Gilbert. He's a consultant and former Universal Music executive. So here it goes. So social media in the next 5 years will evolve into a platform where relationships and conversations between artists and their followers are more important than ever. There will be a lot less of the buy my album, see my show posts, and more asking fans for input, responding to comments, and standing together in special causes around the world. So Morten, do you agree with this? And if so, what communication skills must artists develop to better prepare and improve their social media marketing?
So this is a big question, especially with the time that we're going through right now. I don't know when exactly your source said this, but I think we're already there.
Yes.
I think we are. We're seeing, especially on platforms like Twitter and Instagram, we're seeing a lot more close interaction between, Rihanna at one point gave relationship advice to one of her fans. You know, it's just, we have to remember that artists are human beings, and when they are using social media, they are impacted by the same mechanisms that social media has on everybody. So it's basically, yeah, I think that's going to happen. That also has a flip side, though, and the fact that a lot of artists are also quitting social media or somehow stepping back from it, I think is a sign that they want to maintain a private life that's not necessarily in the spotlight. And they see their social media persona as something that is separate from their own personal life. And so I think we're going to see, in general, more of a divide there. I think we're going to see that there are some artists that will happily do it, and some artists that want, either because they just feel like they need some more privacy, especially in light of what has happened on social media in the last few years, but also because they want maybe to maintain a mystique. Because one thing that goes away with all of this is this idea of the god artist, right? This idea of, you know, right, who is this person that's going to come in and entertain me for 2 hours?
Right.
So I think we're going to see more of a mix, to be honest with you.
I see. Very, very interesting points. Let's move on to the next quote now. So this would be artificial intelligence and tour marketing. And this is by Sydney Alston, he's a manager. So, I see AI's technology being so powerful, it will be able to target anyone who has ever mentioned a specific club on their social media, any band who has ever played that very same club, and any person who has ever checked out that club on the internet. AI's advanced bots will then troll the internet and link your band's digital flyer to tens of thousands of people who will then check out your website and decide if they want to come to your show. So Morten, how plausible do you see this being?
I think it's already happening. I mean, okay, if you're the band I'm in a Pink Floyd tribute band, and it's just for fun, but we do a lot of social media marketing, and what happens there is that we will take advantage of whatever, platform we're working on for our age group, our demo, it's usually Facebook. And so what we do there is that we take advantage of the AI that, that Facebook has that will basically make sure that everybody who is interested in Pink Floyd will that is in our area will see that we're playing. You can buy that. That's just a service. So yeah, I think that's very plausible because it's already happening. I think AI has some more interesting perspectives, both negative and positive, that for musicians that want to market themselves.
Please share them.
Yeah, I think something like AI can be a convenience builder between the music consumer and the artist. And so I think that it will be more something like, you know, you'll have Google Assistant or Alexa or Siri, you know, say, oh, yeah, so I see that you're playing music now. X, Y, and Z artist has just 5 minutes ago released a new track on this platform. Do you want me to play it for you? Cool. So I think that's the kind of personalization that you're going to see in the future. And then, of course, immediately, you know, you'll be able to say, which you can do already now, please add this to my favorites list, or, you know, that kind of thing, or keep following this artist in the future.
And what were the cons?
Well, AI has a lot of cons in general. There's a lot of discrimination going on and bias going on in AI right now. So you have, in this particular example or this market, what you could see, for instance, is you might see male artists being promoted over female artists, white artists being promoted over black artists, that kind of thing. And that's just because nobody's checking the algorithms, right? So that would be one of the cons. The other part of it is that if you have a perception that the AI is fair, that it will recommend stuff to you based on what it knows about you and not what somebody pays it to do, then you might walk around in some kind of delusional state. If it turns out that somebody has actually paid the company that runs the algorithm to recommend this stuff to you. So wow. It's a question of really educating the audience on what to expect, and also to really keep a close eye and regulate, how bias in AI works.
Fascinating stuff. Actually, great. Thanks for sharing that. So let's go ahead now and talk about the third quote, metadata, and we'll talk about how it increases in importance in the coming years. And this is by Aaron Jacobson, an attorney. So I believe that as the digital and streaming world evolve in the next 5 years, the data associated with tracking songs, ownership, and receiving payments will almost be as important, if more important, as the ownership of the songs. So before releasing a track, be sure it is tagged with important information like name and copyright and description of your style. So, Morten, first of all, for those of us that do not know, please explain what metadata is, and then what musicians need to do to ensure that the proper metadata is inputted.
Right. So when we talk about metadata, usually the go-to explanation is it's data about data, but that doesn't mean a lot to a lot of people. So what I usually use as examples is, when you get an image on your computer, you can usually, on a Windows machine, you can sort of right click on it, or you can control click on it with a Mac, and you can get information about that image, right? You can see what camera it was shot with, you can see where it was shot, all that. That's metadata. All that stuff about the digital object that describes it, that sits in the file itself, that's metadata. So the reason why, and your source there is absolutely correct. I mean, I cannot stress this enough. In an environment where artists are, very independent, there are many more independent artists than there ever has been, because there is an infrastructure to support that now. In that environment, it is very, very important that your music can be tracked and found. So if you can't, if you don't have the right information about who wrote the songs and who's the artist and when is it from and who has the rights for it, the copyright, whatever, the AI that we just talked about won't be able to find you, or the Spotify or the other companies that are tracking the usage of your music, the consumption of your music, won't be able to do it correctly because they don't have that information.
Wow. Yeah, very, very interesting. You know, a lot of my students, my music students, you know, this might seem like a very common thing, but a lot of them don't know even, okay, so great. So now what do I do? Like, do I enter the data in during the mastering or when I submit it to Spotify, you know, the digital service providers, or, you know, maybe can you share a little bit?
Sure. I mean, when you put music on Spotify, usually, unless you are very good friends with them, you go through some middleman. CD Baby, for instance, has a service where you can put music on Spotify and other services. And in that process, that's where you do a lot of the tagging. And it's very important that you do it right. And so take the time when you're doing that to familiarize yourself with that process before you start it. Because when you're doing it, you're just thinking, as a musician, you're like, oh, my music is going to be available. And you just want it to be up there. And you can't really bother with all this technical stuff.
Right.
You have to. It's absolutely essential.
So maybe we can just give them a quick list of some of the essentials, because I mean we primarily did, but let's even go deeper.
Right.
So it's not only the name of the song, the genre, it could also be the emotion that the song evokes.
Yes.
It could even be like artists, right?
Yeah.
Anything else in particular you can
think
of?
I mean, then there's all the sort of admin stuff, right? So
right.
you have rights holders, you have I think some places actually, if you've had this released as any sort of CD before, you have to get that, and I'm blanking on the code name right now, but there's a code for that kind of release that the IFPI demands. And that ISRC codes is what they call it. Yeah, the ISRC codes, you need to have that because that has to go into it as well. So there are all these sort of technicalities and that you kind of need to know about.
Right, and very important stuff.
Yeah, especially the rights holders. I mean, if there's any of the songs that might at some point have been, you know, published by a publishing company or, you know, something,
right,
you need to know exactly about the percentages and the age of the licensing agreement, all of that, because you'll get sued if you put music up on Spotify
and
made it available that somebody else has rights
to. Exactly. Okay, well, great. This was the most awesome stuff. Great conversation.
Great.
The future, which really is right now, in a sense, too.
It's
right?
Moving very fast.
So we have been talking, you guys, about music marketing 2025 and essentially broke it down into three areas. We looked at some quotes about social media, some quotes about artificial intelligence, and then finally we finished up on metadata. Make sure to hang out for the next segment. Peace. Thanks. Hey, everybody. If you like the videos that you just watched, please be sure to check out my books, Business Basics for Musicians and Music Marketing for the DIY Musician, available at Amazon.com, BobbyBorg.com, or any fine bookseller. Thanks again for watching, and peace.